同时而家咧系开始有关公务方面嘅环节，为咗咧有秩序同埋公平咁安排议员发言咧，我会请工作人员咧先清除议员已经按下举手嘅标记。好啦，有意发言嘅议员咧，请按下 Zoom 嘅举手功能示意。我会先请发展局局长作简短嘅介绍，随后咧议员就可以提问。首先请局长系简介。
在2023财政年度，发展局在公务方面工作有以下几个重点。在抗疫方面，我们非常感谢中央的全力支援，特区政府和中联办和指派的承建商成立了三方的联系机制，组织公务部门成立了专班，通过各方紧密沟通和协调，是全速兴建八个社区隔离和治疗设施，当中六个已经在上月落成启用了，而在竹篙湾和启德的设施也会在短期之内是分阶段落成的。上述的设施一共可以提供大约40,000个床位，大大地提升了香港的抗疫和隔离方面的能力。在明日大屿的愿景方面，政府预计在2022年的第四季可以就着填海范围、交通基建和走线、土地用途、融资方案四方面提出初步的方案，听取公众的意见。我们本来预计在2027年展开首阶段的填海工程，等首批居民可以在2034年入伙。我们现在研究精简法律和相关行
政。In 2034, the government is striving to streamline the procedures to further advance the above timetable. The government will seek funding approval in the middle of this year to kickstart the planning and engineering study for Long Gu Tang reclamation and replanning of Chuen Mun West area. With a view to strengthening manpower developments, we will propose to inject $1.2 billion into the Construction Innovation and Technology Fund to continue to support the industry's application of advanced construction methods and new technologies, and earmark $30 million to promote applied research and development in public works in the industry, with a view to strengthening the overall productivity and performance of the construction industry. To enhance capability of coastal areas to respond to rising sea level and extreme waves caused by climate change, we plan to take forward appropriate improvement works and management and measures in the next 5 years for 26 coastal low-lying or windy residential areas. Lastly, we will earmark an additional $1 billion for the Built Heritage Conservation Fund to continue implementing the revitalizing historic buildings through partnership scheme collaboration with non-profit making partners, we will revitalize and make good use of historic buildings in innovative ways. The funding will provide financial support for more private owners to maintain the historic buildings, and will further support public engagement and academic research on the theme of built heritage conservation. Thank you. Mr. Chen Hock Fong, Mr. Andrew Lam, Mr. Rock Chen, Mr. Tony Jan, and Dr. Tam Yue Hang. 5 minutes each. Mr. Chen Hock Fong. Thank you, Chairman. Now on DEVB 001, that's my own question. Now the works branch says it would continue to promote the principles of right tree and right place principle, as well as the vegetation diversity principle. And 6 million trees, including shrubs and trees, will be planted in this year. Under the epidemic, we can see that the people are thrilled to have beautiful flowers in the community. They would flock to take photos of them. Now, has the Development Bureau considered planting attractive trees in Lantau and Tung Chung along the Lantau trunk road? I see a lot of beautiful flowers, and that's very refreshing. Earlier on in Shangwan, I saw a lot of people taking picture of a rare tree, and that's very and that was really made a attractive look attraction. People love going to Japan because there are different faunas and floras in different seasons. Of course, we want Hong Kong to continue to be able to attract some tourists. Now, do we have a greening master plan so that we can be more efficient in planting trees and flowers for members of the public's enjoyment and for attracting visitors? Thank you, Mr. Chen. We talk about white trees, right place. We want to protect our slopes, protect soil against erosion, as well as ensuring safety of trees planted and also vegetation diversity. So Mr. Chen's focus was on attraction as well as the aesthetic aspects. But it would be quite a scene with a hillside full of beautiful trees and flowers. So I welcome Mr. Chen and members' suggestions. Now, it may be a little bit different with our principle of right tree at right place, but that may be a direction we can take. Ms. Lee? Yes, concerning Mr. Chen's suggestion, we have the greening master plan for different districts. We have considered the factors mentioned by Mr. Chen in selecting trees. Of course, we would consider about wind resistance and heat resistance of the tree species. On the other hand, in March, in different areas, the trees that we have planted have just blossomed, and a lot of people went to take photos. And also, we have trees for shading and greening purposes in different districts. So whenever possible, we would consider factors like vegetation diversity and the size of the tree crowns, as well as the attractiveness of the trees. So we will bear these in mind in the future when we plant trees. Follow-up question. So there was a period of time when we planted the same species of trees, a species from Taiwan and in Hong Kong for a long time. So it is about time that the trees are replanted. That is the Acacia confusa. So can we consider replanting so that we have a theme in Hong Kong? Like Ms. Lee said, we have considered the aesthetical attractiveness of trees. So in the past 10 to 20 years, we were more focused on protecting slopes, vegetation diversity, and so on. In terms of attractiveness and placemaking, I think that's a direction we can try. In terms of replacing the Acacia confucus, I will consult Mr. Chen on this. Yes, in term, I would like to know how many trees, how many Acacia confucia needs to be replanted and so on. Mr. Andrew Lam, thank you, Chairman, and thank you, Secretary. Reply 005, my own question about the modular integrated construction or MIC construction model. I myself are all for this construction method. In the reply, it is mentioned that the governments would like to apply MIC method in capital works project. So in terms of housing projects, there are many projects using MIC model. In terms of public housing projects, however, the uptake rate is lower. Most of the projects have adopted the prefabricated construction model. So I would like to know the collaboration between your bureau and the THB. Would you increase the uptake rate of MIC, and what is the difficulty? I'm also involved in transitional housing projects myself. I have a first-hand experience. The direction is correct. In reality, there are lots of operational details to be ironed out. For example, remote quality monitoring. There is difficulty. So how long do we have to resort to a remote manner of monitoring? We don't know. The factories are located in the mainland and Malaysia. So how can we make sure that the quality control is in place? Because it would take a lot of time and efforts to rectify the mistakes. So what measures and what plans do the Development Bureau have in mind? Thank you, Mr. Lam. In terms of promoting MIC in our projects, the Development Bureau is the main facilitator. Yes, the THB has not been very much involved in this. However, like 2 days ago, the THB said that there are 3 projects using MIC method, and some 20,000 public housing units will be built with the prefabricated construction model. Mr. Frank Chen said, for sites on near the hillside, when the site is narrow shaped, it may be more difficult to use the method. In an NDA, it's like a Tung Chung, the site is fast and flagged. MIC method will be suitable. So the THB is increasing the uptake of the MIC method in terms of remote quality control. Ricky? Yes, thank you. Many factories providing MIC services are located in the mainland. We had to go to the mainland for quality control. So the epidemic has affected us to a certain extent. However, we are still able to monitor the quality by installing cameras in the factories to monitor the procedures. And also with QR tags, we can monitor the quality of raw materials and the fabrication as well as the delivery. Thank you. Some follow-up. Now, from my first-hand experience, I can tell you that there is still a gap between the reality and the idea. So I think you have to implement a comprehensive DIM, including quality control as the factories, as well as on-site fabrication and assembly on site. The application of BIM is still limited. So we should work to enhance the monitoring regime. In reality, it is common to have a default, and it is a headache for us to rectify the defaults. I agree with Mr. Lam. DIM is very useful. So we will keep in touch with Mr. Lam. Mr. Rock Chen, 2 questions. In relation to the opening remarks, on DVB 004, in relation to the construction of isolation facilities. In your opening remarks, the Secretary said, with the full support of the Central People's Government, the government's liaison office and the designated contractor has established a tripartite liaison mechanism. And works departments are organized to set up a task force through close communication. 8 community isolation and treatment facilities have been built in 3 months. That is a record speed. So, is worth appraising. Now the government is looking to streamline development procedures, so that is also welcomed. So my question is, how we can replicate this efficiency onto other public works in Hong Kong. Now the compulsory universal test has been put on hold, and it seems that the isolation and treatment facility at the isolation facilities have a lot of spare capacity. So what is the operational situation of these isolation facilities. Who is in charge? How can we make sure that these facilities built with the help of the mainland government, the central government is not wasted?
I'd like to follow up on reply 006. It is said that for 26 low-lying coastal areas and windy places, you're going to make improvements. They're the coastal areas. This is to be given recognition. In 5 years, such improvement projects will be launched one after another, like increasing the height of the sea walls and making sure that there will be flood barriers to keep off the surge. Why do we have to wait for 5 years? We may be experiencing super typhoons, super rainstorms, and low-lying areas will be vulnerable to such coastal hazards. So why 5 years, and do you have any contingency plan to make sure that our lives and properties are safeguarded? Thank you, Mr. Chen, Mr. Rock Chen, for your questions. Let me take the last question first. For the projects to protect the coastal low-lying areas, for those situated on government land, and if the issue is simple, we can start early and it can be completed in 1 year's time. But then for privately owned sites, if we want to carry out government works, we have to have a negotiation. So it may take a few years' time. For other work, it may have a larger scope, and there are many issues like private land, hundreds of flats, etc. And our experience tells us that it may take between 3 to 5 years' time. For the details, I think I can have a separate occasion to explain the matter to Mr. Chen. Yes, a quick follow-up. For the 26 locations, can you not sort of prioritize them on the basis of risk? Even if it is situated on private land, if it carries a high risk, I think even private land owners need to cooperate with the government. Yes, noted. Before the work is completed, there will be some management measures. Among the 20 plus locations, there are quite a lot of them already been protected by some temporary measures. We'll talk to the HAD as well as other departments. We will make sure that we are clear about the management measures. Before the new improvement project is in place, in the interim, we'll still make sure that the risk is manageable. For the isolation and treatment facilities, I think Mr. Frank Chen has commented on that. By having such facilities, as the C has said, that would boost our capability to cope with the epidemic. With the infection easing, I think there is potential to put such facilities to good use. Well, in the case of Chengdi, instead of putting up for tender for logistics use, maybe that can be sort of reinstated. For other locations, many of them are being run by the disciplined services. And then for maintenance, it is the responsibility of the developer or the contractor. Mr. Tung Yi Chen. I think the secretary has said that we had the support of the central government, and with high efficiency, we were able to build each community isolation and treatment facilities, providing a total of 40,000 beds. In addition to the mainland's assistance, I need to say and put on record here that for the Development Bureau as well as its works departments, I think their colleagues have also contributed hugely so as to make sure that such facilities are completed. I must express my gratitude. Now, if I may go to reply 002. For the community isolation and treatment facilities, they were built so efficiently. Vis-a-vis that, reply 002 isn't quite satisfactory. there were 70 out of, there were 70 projects experiencing delays. On average, a delay of 9 months, approaching almost 80%. 70 out of 90 major category projects. Do you have an analysis of the reasons? And are you able to minimize the delay in future? Have you carried out any evaluation? Thank you, Mr. Chair. In our reply, we have pointed out that for the delays, they are attributable to different reasons. Say, for example, it has taken us more time to go through the statutory process. Inclement weather is also a factor. They were sort of experienced in the past, though not all of them were within our control. In future, for anything that is within the control of the government, we'll try our best to address them. Say, for example, we have the we have a college for the leaders of major projects. We'll train them, and we have this center of excellence for major project leaders. We aim at a high level of quality. We want to deliver the project on time. In recent years, and it has been mentioned by many members, that is the use of MIC. We are advocating the use of MIC. This will mean that we can expedite the pace and we can have it under our control. Yes, while you're on MIC, if I may also look at reply 005. In paragraph 3, it is said that it is hoped that you want the private sector to adopt MIC as well. As an incentive, there is a concession of floor area and it will be increased from the current 6% to 10%. So what is the rationale? Initially, you provided a 6% concession. Has it been proved that it was not attractive? By enhancing it to 10%, are you confident that it will be a good enough incentive for the private sector to adopt MIC? We are now proposing to increase it. This is evidence-based. While we have been promoting MIC, we have learned from the feedback of the market. If MIC is to be adopted, the thickness of the wall will be increased. In other words, the internal usable floor area will be reduced. So we try to see by how much it will be increased. On average, it is said that it will be 10%. So we say that a 10% concession vis-a-vis the original 6% should make MIC more attractive to the private sector. Secretary, even if you want to increase it to 10%, I think it was introduced only recently. So I guess you haven't seen any results. We're watching it. 6%, 10% is surely better than 6%. And it isn't a figure plucked from thin air. We based the decision on certain figures. Next, Mr. Tan Yueheng. Thank you, Chair. I would like to follow up on my question. I would like to follow on 011, reply 011. And this is about the Construction Innovation and Technology Fund. I'm most grateful to the Bureau for giving me a very detailed reply. Thank you very much. In your reply, you mentioned that in year 2018, October, a fund of $1 billion was set up. And by February this year, $600 million have been spent. According to the sort of number of applications received, In February 2023, the fund will be exhausted. That is, the whole amount of money will be spent in 4.5 years. In other words, we are also trying to inject another $1 billion into it, or $1.2 billion. With the additional $1.2 billion, for how long a time will it last? Because in year 2021, according to a survey, 94% of the construction industry personnel would like to see an enhancement of work safety there. And for 46% of the interviewees said that it will take us 5 years to apply innovation technology. I think you need a lot of input. For the 4.5 years in the past, you spent $1 billion. Now you inject $1.2 billion. I think I just wonder if that amount of money is good enough. Can it meet the medium-term requirement of our industry? Thank you, Mr. Tang, for your question. I would like to give a reply. Anything that is of help to the construction industry will be introduced by us, and we want to have a further injection of capital, and we look forward to the LegCo's approval. This won't be the last time that we inject the money into the fund. At different stages, we need different plans. By having an additional $1.2 billion, we believe that they can see us for another 5 years. But then if the money is spent quickly, then it will be a good sign. If it is used up in 4.5 years, then at an appropriate juncture, we'll come back to make an application, and we look forward to your support. But of course, we have to move from one stage to another. Thank you. Next, Mr. Tong Lee Chair, 5 minutes. Thank you, Chair. Mr. Chairman, if I may follow up on my own question and reply 016. In Annex 3, for List 2 or Band 2, architectural consultants, the number of projects undertaken is zero. I hope you can benefit different types of consultants. Why nothing for Band 2? Is it because there wasn't any works project suitable for the participation by Band 2 consultants? And then the administration has been asked by the professionals to make sure that SMEs can be given the opportunity to take part in the public works. We hope that you can have the right arrangements in place so that even SME consultants can take part. We are grateful to the ASD for making certain arrangements. Sometimes a project may be huge in size, but then you will ask for a task to be broken up so that even Band 3 architectural consultants can take part. I would like to know about the response. You have given us some figures. There were 12 such projects. But then for small and medium consultants, there are a large number of them. But then in the past, they thought that they didn't have the chance. And so since they knew that they might not stand a good chance, they didn't pay much attention to the opportunities. So while you are providing more opportunities, are you also trying to publicize the arrangement so as to make sure that they can benefit from your new arrangement. And with their participation, I'm sure they can give you certain innovative ideas. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Chair, for your question. I would invite Ms. Ho from the Arch SD to take the question. Thank you. I would like to explain table three. It seems that a band two consultants didn't participate in any D&B works projects. For design and build projects, they would be of a sizable scale, usually projects involving more than $2 billion. So mostly the team would be comprised of architects from band one consultants. Now we have been promoting a new policy in recent years for D&B projects and projects awarded to private consultants. We would encourage them to collaborate with professionals and architects from band three. So there are more opportunities available now for smaller projects, for example, parks run by LCSD and small scale works projects. They would be separated in tendering out so that band three architects have more opportunities to get involved. So for outsourced projects, there are some 60 projects undertaken by band one and band two architects. We have band two architectural consultants are very active in our D&B in our projects. However, the table is about a D&B works project, so they were undertaken by band one architects. Now in table three, there is a category works projects undertaken by other architectural consultants, and the value involved is $6.8 billion. So can you explain that? Thank you, Chairman. Now, they are classified as other architectural consultants. For D&B works projects, there are eight projects undertaken by a band one architectural consultants. So these are other architectural consultants. They are not involved in the design stage. However, they are engaged by the project consultants in charge to help with the project. So they are classified as other architectural consultants. Mr. Chen Xiuhong. Thank you, Chair. Just now, the secretary didn't reply my question head on. That is, with the help of the Central People's Government, a lot of isolation facilities were built. So how can we replicate the successful experience onto other projects? Now on my own question, that is 003. In the budget, it is proposed that construction industry council would be allocated with $1 billion for manpower training. I think it would help to enhance the capacity of the talent pool. Now the CIC has done a good job. Many people were trained each year. However, not a lot of these graduates would join the industry. Now, very often the governments would shout out money to help improve the image of the build of the construction industry. However, the result is not satisfactory. In fact, the wages of the construction industry is higher than a lot of desk jobs. However, because of the perception that construction industry practitioners are have to is dirty as well as dangerous, and that's why not many people join the industry. So how will the government help improve the image of the construction industry and offer more opportunities to fill the talent shortage? Now, in the next 6 years, $1 billion will be allocated to help upskill the intermediate tradesmen to tradesmen. Now, we understand that demand for construction talents will be high because of the Northern Metropolis projects and so on. Now, according to your assessment, is the amount of talents sufficient to meet the demand? If not, will the government consider planning ahead, for example, importing labors to fill the gap? Thank you for your question. Previously, there was insufficient time for me to answer the question. Now I will supplement. Now, for this batch of isolation facilities completed with the help of the mainland, I can truly feel the care of the country for Hong Kong, and they have really given us a lot of help. When resources and the manpower is in place, progress can be very swift and miracle can be achieved. In terms of policy, I reckon that streamlining procedures do have an effect. However, for non-urgent cases, we have to make sure that the justice of procedural justice is observed. I think Mr. Chen Shih-hung would also support us in terms of streamlining and development control in other for other cases. For MIC, Hong Kong is uniquely located. There are a lot of MIC production bases in the GBA. Constructed units can be shipped to Hong Kong in just one day. Compared with other places, the MIC bases are located far away. So adopting MIC method is the right way to go for Hong Kong. In terms of increasing the number of construction talents, the CIC is currently undertaking a study, the results of which will be available in the third quarter. I will keep in touch with Mr. Chen about the study. It does not just cover frontline workers, but also the professionals. So a final point, we are doing our best to improve the construction industry image. We have the award scheme, and also Mr. Chen, the chairman of the CIC, has organized sports events and so on. We understand that it is a difficult job. The construction industry. However, we will work with Mr. Chen to enhance our efforts in improving the image. Mr. Tony Chair, 5 minutes. Thank you, Chair. I would like to follow up on my previous question on reply 016. A question has not been answered. That is in table 4. The Architectural Services Department projects that for year 2022 to 23, there will be 12 projects open to participation by Band 3 architectural consultants. Well, maybe my question comes too early. For Band 3 architectural consultants, only very few of them participated in government's projects. So some architect, so some band-free architectural consultants no longer pay attention to the opportunities. So how can we promote these projects, these opportunities to band-free architectural consultants for their participation? And also, is the architectural services department aware of the response of a band one architectural consultants concerning these works projects? Are there any worries on their part? Ms. Ho, Director for Architectural Services. Thank you. Now, for the ArchSD, we have a lot of opportunities open up for Band 1, Band 3, and Band 2 and Band 3 architectural consultants. For DNB projects, most of the participants are Band 1 architectural consultants. We have projects of different scales. So there are equal participation opportunities by Band 1 to 3 architectural consultants. On the table, we only have a breakdown between DNB works projects and also projects are led by Band 1 architectural consultants. There is a requirement that they have to involve Band 3 architectural consultants. However, there are smaller scale projects. And whenever we come across suitable small scale projects for Band 3 architectural consultants, we will surely involve them. In the past few years, we have been very progressive in organizing a design competition, particularly for small scale projects suitable for Band 3 architectural consultants. We will surely organize more of these events if this is proven to be successful. So we will definitely take on board Mr. Jay's suggestion. We will promote opportunities to band-free architectural consultants. There is a long list of such consultants. We can explore ways to enhance communication with them. Chairman, I wonder if the director can give me more details. Now for table four, the table is limited to band-free consultants. So what about SMEs? In year 2022 and 2023, are there any projects suitable for SMEs to participate? So please supplement me with the information after the meeting. Mr. Michael Look, would you please change your background, because the rule is that you should display the color black background according to your constituency. Sorry, Chair, I was in another meeting. Now, I would like to follow up on my question. That's 016. That's a question put forward by me on MIC. Application. Now, the reply is rather vague. It is just said that there are projects using MIC, but there are no figures. Now, can the Bureau provide us with figures? For example, for public housing estates with high demand, how many of them are being built with MIC? And what is the reason for not using MIC? Now, the industry told me that the MIC is construction method is very mature compared with a conventional construction method, and there is not much difference in terms of aesthetic and quality, if not even better. However, there are concerns whether MIC would affect the employment opportunities of local builders. Now, on the prefabricated units, the government said that there are some local companies intending to join the business. So it may require a rather large site, which is currently vacant. So would the government offer any policy incentives to encourage businesses to set up factories for MIC, at the same time ensuring the employment opportunities for local builders?
Thank you for your question. Let me talk about the case of public housing. I think a day or two ago, the director of housing said that there are three projects deploying MIC. And Mr. Frank Chen, STH, also said that 10, 20,000 housing units should be suitable for the use of MIC for both the public as the private sectors. Yes, we would like to have more extensive use of MIC. So far, we have got 70 such projects. I'll be happy to tabulate the information for Mr. Look. Now, for the prefabrication of the units, I think by getting them outside of Hong Kong, it can address one of our problems, that is shortage of manpower as well as the aging of the manpower. Despite the use of MIC, there are still a lot of work that can only be carried out on the site itself. For example, bar fixing. Mr. Luke is right. If we are to have a large scale plant locally to manufacture and store the MIC units, it may not make economic sense. Maybe Mr. Luke wasn't here when I gave the reply to the earlier question. 10, 20,000 units have been built by deploying MIC for the purpose of isolation and treatment. Hong Kong has this advantage. We are just so near to the source of the MIC plants. They can come via a land route or water route, and that can drive down the cost. I just wonder if the government can provide a favorable land policy so as to enable the development of an MIC plant locally. Well, I don't think there is a favorable land policy for such. I have to be frank with you. Now, for business activities, we have to stress the importance of being fair. Of course, I can't rule out anything. For Hong Kong to develop the manufacturing of MIC units, we just have to beg the question whether it is practical and realistic. Has anybody approached us saying that the government should grant a large piece of land to manufacture MIC modules? The question is, nobody has come forward. Maybe in terms of transportation or whatnot, I think we can do something about it. Next, Ms. Hong. Secretary, if I may follow up on what Mr. Michael Look has said, that is having local manufacturing of MIC modules. The secretary said that we have a manufacturing base nearby in Guangdong province, but I don't think that's the real picture. In fact, land transport between the mainland and Hong Kong has been disrupted. So the materials cannot be sent to Hong Kong. And then I don't think it's making good environmental protection sense. We need $200 to $300 billion worth of MIC modules. I think we should develop the business locally. You say that it is going to be difficult, but I think we need to enrich our industrial structure for the benefit of our future generation. So I think Hong Kong should seriously consider the manufacturing of MIC modules locally. Yes, it may have to make use of a lot of land resources, but then for the northern metropolis, we are going to have 300 square kilometers of land available. You can make use of that site. Yes, Ms. Hong's point just noted, we cannot rule the possibility or the feasibility. Still, we have to talk to the industry for certain tasks, for bar fixing, for prefabrication of such tasks. Some of them is already being carried out locally. Do we have other members wishing to ask questions? If not, then that's the end of today's session. I would like to thank the secretary as well as the other profit officers. And then we'll resume at 9 o'clock on the 14th of April for the next session. Thank you.